There we go. And we thank you for joining us. If you don't know me, my name is Dawn Cannon Rich, but I go by Nikki. So one of those rare individuals that my parents named me one thing and called me something entirely different my entire life. So preferred name is Nikki. Personal pronouns are she, hers. I am one of the research services librarians here at Georgia Southern Libraries and also the Affordable Learning Georgia Library Champion, so the OER librarian. And today we're going to be joined by some of our great faculty members who have been working with OER in their courses. And we've kept these small to facilitate conversations. So y'all please feel free to unmute and ask questions or make comments or utilize the chat if you're more comfortable with that. I will be monitoring chat for the group. We'll also be placing some resources in chat for you. And we will make those resources available to you after the session. So if you miss them in chat, you can catch them after. We're going to be moderated today by our own Dr. Chelda Smith, who is an associate professor in the Department of Elementary and Special Ed in our College of Education. Her research interest areas are the sociology of education, critical pedagogy, critical literacy, asset-based pedagogy, and she is also one of our OER heroes here on this campus, so she can add her insight on this as well. So at this moment, I will turn it on to Dr. Chelda Smith.
Thank you, Nikki. So I'm just going to tell you a little bit about my experience with OER at Georgia Southern University. And as I'm telling my quick story, feel free to ask any questions in the chat, or when I'm done, feel free to also just ask me anything and I'll do my best to answer those questions. So I applied for my first ALG grant in 2015, and it was rejected. The grant we submitted was to replace the textbook for a cultural issues class that was taught in the summer. It was taught every semester, about 10 sections of it, because it was the only class that was required for every student in College of Ed. So it'd be like 10 sections. So it would have a great impact if we could replace the textbooks that we had, which is what the grant we wrote for. We want to replace our textbook. We want to make it more accessible. And in my field of cultural issues and all things critical pedagogy, we know that activists and youth are really the ones who are driving the conversation about what's most relevant. And so it becomes even more important that the resources that we're using are live and current. The more we learn about what terminology is important, the more our textbooks become outdated because they're not updating that language right away, or they're not framing things in the most culturally responsive ways. So this was a really attractive thing for me to consider doing. And because we had not only 10 sections every semester, but we would have random faculty teaching it who maybe didn't have all the expertise that we would desire, we were trying to create a course shell that would have the basic activities, all the resources. And so our goal of accessibility was just not only for our students to be able to have this material for free, but also so that our faculty would have the best and most current material, even if they didn't have the expertise or the time to look for all of that. So it was in two part, professional development and student accessibility. Like I said, it was rejected the first time, but it came back with incredibly detailed and supportive feedback that allowed us to revise in just 1 month, I think it was, because at the time for the ALG grants, they're about, they have cycles, and the next cycle was pretty quick. So we revised it based on the feedback and we got it accepted right away. That was in 2015. Since then, I've become an ALG champion. And this year, for that same kind of field, we just got awarded a ALG grant to create a textbook for the entire program, which is the same goal in mind of creating somewhat professional development for our faculty so that everybody has that lens of inclusive excellence. Everybody has access to material that's representative of women and people from traditionally marginalized groups, while making sure that we don't have this financial barrier to our students in terms of being able to access a textbook. So that is, in a nutshell, my experience with getting ALG grants, but also really in an institutional and formal way, making open educational resources accessible to both our students and our faculty members. And then really at large, because we often publish it in ways that are accessible to everyone else within the, who has access either to the College of Ed, our library guide, or Digital Commons, which is our repository. I think I see some questions. Nope. Okay, so if there are no direct questions right now, I wanted to see if Priya and, is it Beulah? Yep, if either one of them felt comfortable maybe explaining what your relationship to OER and ALG is.
I can go. Okay. I can go first. So I'm in the Department of Mechanical Engineering. So I primarily teach programming for engineers. So this is a freshman level course. And if you have any inkling of or have dealt with software, it changes. I mean, it changes pretty rapidly. Textbooks, okay, are not just expensive, but they also are updated, okay, very regularly, which also means, okay, students had to not just, okay, spend money on the software that they needed, but also for a brand new textbook every semester, okay, because of all the updates in the software itself. Years ago, I think it was 2015 or 2016, I applied for an ALG grant, and I had been creating online YouTube tutorials for this software for a number of years before that. A team of us got together and said, hey, why can't we put this together in a website and make it the textbook, the online textbook for the course? So I did apply, and we got really turned down majorly because we didn't have the sample size. This was when we were Armstrong State, and this was like one section, even if it was every semester, it was like 10 to 15 students, okay? And those were our lab class sizes at that time. I also applied for an NSF grant, okay? Granted during that time to maybe expand it beyond the university itself, but both were rejected, and I was pretty depressed by that time because the NSF grant especially takes a lot of time and effort to even put something together. When after the merger, I started the conversation once again with faculty and across campuses within my department saying, hey, I have done all this work. Students like it. Why not collaborate? So that's what we did. And we reapplied last year for an ALG grant, and we were funded. Some of the reviewers and Jeff Gallant, who oversees ALG, he was well aware of my work. I sent him some emails, got some questions immediately answered by him. And I was able to tailor to really what the reviewers would be looking for in the grant. We're still working on it. It's in full implementation stage this semester, which means all sections of the course are using the textbook, both campuses, and we're in the process of assessment. So I feel we're pretty good about it. I mean, we'll continue to do this. We've had good comments from both students and faculty members who are using it. Going back to that, what I mentioned about updates, this means that not only is the software now completely free because of what we work through ITS services to allow our students to have that, which means they don't have to pay for any updates on the software itself, but because this is now a completely online resource, it's so much easier to update. Any version updates, we just can go ahead and I'll add that to the code and update it on the server. And I mean, it's pretty much an almost instantaneous process to do that. And if anyone is interested, I'm happy to share the website, and and you can feel your way around it pretty easily.
Thank you so much, Priya. One thing I'll say is I'm also comfortable sharing not only our resource once it's finished, because we just got ours funded last fall, but I'm also happy to share our application, because sometimes something can feel really overwhelming because you don't know what all it takes to put that application together. So feel free to reach out if you want to see the version of the application that was submitted.
Yeah, likewise.
Dula?
Hey everyone, I'm Dula Navendra Kuraku. I'm from the chemistry department in Statesboro campus. So I teach chemistry for engineering majors. It's a pretty introductory level chemistry. It's basically two semesters of chemistry smushed together for engineering majors. And what I have seen is, one, the content is vast. The amount of material that we cover is vast in 1 week. And the textbook costs are pretty high too. So the textbook for the course is about $120. So one semester I gave a survey, I was just interested in how students are using these resources. We made them buy the textbook. And additionally, because it's a large class, we have 200 students taking the course at a time, and we have two sections, and each one has 200 students in the fall and about 150 students in each class in the spring. So it's a big class. So added to the textbook cost, there is also an iClicker cost, and then there is lab manual cost. So one semester, I just gave a survey and I wanted to know how students are using these resources. And it was shocking that a very small portion of the class actually uses the textbook, even though they buy it. And over the course of time in my evaluations, student evaluations and reviews, I got comments about how I also supplement my instruction with YouTube videos, and students have been commenting on her YouTube videos are good. So I wanted to compile them too. And also one major thing that I came to know is students shuffle the internet more than they use the textbook, which we all know, they're good content in the in YouTube Khan Academy tutorials and lots of great tutorial chemistry YouTube channels. So I myself, if I were a student, that would probably be my first resort. So, and also I looked at other options to create content such as Top Hat. They provided a platform. They also provide a platform where you can edit your textbook, but it comes with a cost. So as I was thinking about this, how to create my own resources, or how to provide them to the students free of cost, because I myself, I came from India, and all the big textbooks, the $120 textbooks, they are like available in the library, and we used to use them as references. But the textbook that we used for the course, it was made in such a way that it was accessible for everybody. So coming from that background, I felt that for engineering majors, since they have a lot of other costs associated with their engineering courses, I wanted to make my course accessible for everybody, because whatever the learning is already available on the internet. As I was thinking about this, Nikki and Debbie Walker from CTE, they led this OER workshop, and I went to it, and my other colleagues also came, and they were also interested in doing something similar. So we went ahead and collaborated. And initially our plan was short. We were thinking about like putting worksheets or other resources for students. And then since we were doing it for this many number of students, we were first thinking of applying a mini grant, but then later we thought, okay, we are doing worksheets. Okay, why not put worksheets and videos and everything into an already available textbook resource? For example, OpenStax Chemistry. It's a free textbook resource that is already on the internet, okay? So we thought we will borrow the OER resources that are textbooks that are already available there, glean the information, you know, from those already available OER textbooks, and then supplement it with YouTube videos and also problem sets for each chapter. And our goal was also to make the content very relatable to engineering majors and also organize the chapters in a way that is more conducive for this engineering chemistry. Because as I said, most of the textbooks are written for a two semester sequence, and there are lots of chapters. Information is scattered over multiple chapters. So we wanted to put them together and create a textbook which focuses the material for engineering majors so that the content can be covered in one semester only. So that was our goal. We wrote a proposal. Thanks to, again, Nikki and Debbie Walker, their resources were really helpful. And our first proposal was rejected. We got good comments though, but I think we were not able to reduce our textbook costs as much as the ALG wanted us to. So in the next proposal, we came up with ideas. We didn't make the lab, we didn't factor in the lab cost. We just focused on the iClicker and the textbook cost, how much we were able to cut down. So we were able to submit the second proposal, and our proposal was accepted, and then the actual work started. It took us we started in May of 2019, and by December, we were able to host our textbook on LibGuides. And Jeffrey was really helpful in helping us with HTML. We don't have to learn the entire HTML, but it was helpful because if we wanted to tweak any problem, if we wanted to organize the content, learning how to write some equations and put them into our textbook, it was helpful to get in touch with HTML for only that particular part. So the great thing is now if I want to go in there and add any content, add any videos, because of COVID, we collected lots of videos for the course. So now we can now embed them into the textbook, and students can go back, and if they prefer watching a video, instead of shuffling the internet and watching videos that don't help, here we are providing them videos and resources that are actually matching with what we teach and what we want them to learn. So, yep, so that's our OER story, and I can show you the LibGuides textbook. We use that as a platform to post, and if you have any questions about the journey or anything, please feel free to ask.
Thank you so much, Beulah. So Nikki put the LibGuide, your LibGuide, in the chat. I really want to encourage you all to click on this. I'm looking at it right now on a different screen. It's so beautiful. I don't like chemistry at all. And I'm like, wow, because it seems very accessible. And I think what I want to capture from what Beulah just shared, which is really important, is the ability to target your audience when you create your own resources, which we already know as instructors, but just this idea of creating a chemistry textbook specifically for engineers versus a chemistry textbook for people approaching chemistry. Right. And so I imagine that if Beulah's team needed to, they could create a chemistry textbook just for practicing teachers, which would be in my field, again, which is going to look different than just a general chemistry textbook. And so that ability to really refine your text is really empowering. The other thing, if you do click on Beulah's chemistry textbook, I'm looking at chapter 13, the electrochemistry chapter. And immediately I see a picture of a car, and I'm wondering, is this Georgia Southern's campus that this car is from?
So the electrochemistry chapter, I didn't create this. I'm thinking this picture is taken from the OpenStax, if I'm not wrong.
Okay. Think about how culturally responsive it would be for students to be able to see this concept that you're teaching, with an image from the campus that they're studying on. That ability to just bring them in because they can relate to the material so quickly. But yeah, it does look like Georgia Southern's campus, but yeah, maybe it is from a textbook instead.
I think it is from the OpenStax textbook, but that was a good suggestion. I can look for pictures that actually belong to the campus and add them. And that's a good point, actually, making it relevant for students to connect with pictures or any of the content that can be connected to what they can relate to. I think it does wonders in getting them motivated and connect.
Yeah, and then I think another point of Beulah's that I want to touch on is this notion of students originally not really engaging the textbook that they were spending so much money on to get in the first place, and that they were more comfortable with the internet resources. Nikki, can you talk a little bit about the analytic supports that we get when we create a LibGuide or anything else to really be able to see to what degree are students engaging with our resources online?
Sure. And I do want to make it clear that this is a choice by these faculty to use the library guide. It's not necessary when you create OER. There's no requirement that you use a library guide. They opted to use it because of the fact that we use them often in our courses with students. So students were already familiar with them. They will integrate into the learning management system. And so it's already compatible with what's being used on Georgia Southern's campus. And I tell people all the time, LibGuides are essentially dummy proof, in all honesty. I mean, this is why I think just about every library in the United States seems to have adopted them. They are easy, easy to update, easy to create, easy to change out. And you already have a full team of folks, myself included, who, I mean, I'm building a new LibGuide every day, just about. So it's very, very quick to add up that shell. In the case of Dr. Smith's group, it's gonna include a lot of links, a lot of document files that are just easily accessible to their students as they're going through the course. In the case of Beulah's class, we actually took the HTML available from OpenStax and were able to integrate it in, so it's just fully there. It created the whole guide. So students can read that text right there, you know, on the guide. We also make sure that PDFs are available to them. So if there's any reason they can't access that text, you know, weak internet or something of that nature, they do have the option to access that material in a different format. We have made Beulah and her crew editors of the guide. So they can go in, and with just a little bit of training from Jeffrey Mortimer and myself, they are able to change out the videos, change out the images, any problem sets that they decide to change in the future. It's very easy for them to get in there and edit that material. And if anyone else ends up teaching this course in the future, we can also add them as an editor of the guide so that they could also get in there and do any necessary edits and updates. So I know that Jeffrey especially helped make sure all the HTML was formatted properly, image showed up properly, tables, equations were the major difficult thing for a chemistry textbook. Those lovely symbols that go into equations were not always the easiest to replicate. So he provided a lot of help in that. If you're in a field, however, that is mostly text and possibly image-based, a whole lot easier for us than the chemistry world, I will have to say. But again, it's not a requirement. That's what they chose to use. We have a few others who have chosen. Organic chemistry is now on a LibGuide. We will soon have education materials, like I said, there are a couple of others, but ALG will host as well. So if you're applying for the Affordable Learning Georgia grant, they will host these materials as well. Sometimes it's more appropriate for materials to be made available in something like Digital Commons, which is also available to you at Georgia Southern. And if you're not a Georgia Southern person, perhaps your institution has an institutional repository. There are other platforms available. Lumen Learning, Pressbooks, a lot of these other things are available for hosting the materials. because it is important to remember if you're doing ALG, you cannot simply put it on Folio or the learning management system, because that is not open to everyone. It's only open to Georgia Southern students. It's only open to Georgia Southern students in your class at that moment. Part of your agreement with Affordable Learning Georgia is that you do make these materials open, which means they are accessible to anyone out there who would want to utilize them.
Priya shared with us her MATLAB textbook. Priya, what platform are you using here?
It is a complete website. So it's housed by our Georgia Southern server, but it is accessible to anybody online. And we have a separate YouTube channel called MATLAB Marina that goes in hand with it as well. And the reason we did that is one for easier updates, because we have also the software, codes associated with it. We don't have as many equations, not for this one, and the codes, it was just easier to have an independent setup. Now we do, on our team, Chris Williams is, he's a faculty member on the computer science department. So I had him to go to with any of, IT, computer science, programming related questions for that. So he helped us set that up. So another advantage of putting it there is Google Analytics does a great job. It's very simple to set up, and it does a good job of tracking. Tracks locations, IP addresses, times, how much time per user they spend on the site. So that helps us assess that, if our students are just clicking on a link and going away, or are they clicking on that website and staying over there for 20 minutes, which means they're actually, looking at the material. So that's part of our assessment.
Thank you. Yes. And I saw where Amanda asked the question of Beulah. I'm going to jump in and try to answer that also for us. And then Beulah, if you could also answer that question of if there's any surveys of your students and the analytics show how much more they're viewing the OER versus the textbook. Well, what we know is if they don't have the textbook, they're definitely not looking at it. But with this, they all have it, per se, right? Because it's made completely accessible and free to them, so long as they have the internet. With the analytics, what we can see is, in addition to everything Priya just mentioned, we can also see what is getting a lot of traction. What are students, sometimes they share the resources, they're so excited about it. Or they share it with another person who's in another section of the course, but they're sharing it. So we get to see when we do our revisions, what really worked or what didn't. And one of the things that I do in all of the classes I teach is every semester I do a mid-semester eval, and I ask three questions of my students. What's working? What's not working? What do you think of the resources? And is there anything you would suggest we add? Because in as much as our students are engaging in this content, they're also coming to it with their own perspectives of how they've been relating to this. And so it's always interesting to see what articles that they think is great for us to add and share with everyone, or videos that they've seen. So I would recommend you do that sort of mid-semester survey, just really casually and informally, because at minimum, it just allows them to vent about things that are not working and you can tweak your pedagogy pretty quickly. Beulah?
Okay. So yes, we did a survey in the semester 2019 fall semester that we were preparing the courses. We got a survey. We were using the traditional textbook, and we got a survey. We asked students what they use the textbook for, how much they use it to read, how much they use it to help with homework, how much they use it to study for exam, prepare for exam. So if they have been studying for the course using other resources, what are they, and to what extent they use them? So we collected all this data in the semester before we changed the resources. And then in the spring, we moved to the OER textbook, and we had the same survey. COVID happened in spring, so we didn't get much of response because all the survey we were collecting online, you know, we always get good responses when you collect the survey in person. So, but based on what we, the survey data that we have, the last fall and last spring, what we saw was this, the responses for pre-transformation and post-transformation were similar, but we found that the students in the spring semester when COVID hit, I think that's where they reported a little bit, even though the sample size was small, so we have to take what the survey results with a pinch of salt. So we saw a spike in, not significantly high, but a little bit of spike in students saying that they have been using the textbook. The takeaway from our, of course, the COVID affected survey results are that students use them, they don't see these resources as any less than traditional textbook resources. So we got the same amount of response for how they, a similar kind of response for how they use it. But the major thing is these are free of cost and students have them from day one. And they have problem sets here, even if students don't read the entire textbook. I wish they read because I think they gain a lot by reading textbook. At least the problem sets, you know, they look at those here. And then there are videos in here. I think what COVID did is we would expect that students will be using this textbook more, but at the same time, we have been providing our recorded lectures to them during the COVID time. So if they have to choose between going to the textbook and looking at the videos, I think students prefer just watching the lecture videos that we have recorded. So we don't know yet. I'm hoping that, you know, we can collect again data when all this COVID is over and see how students have been interacting with this textbook. Definitely one thing that I would like to reform is going from here is definitely the text. I want to condense it a little bit more and make it even more readable. That's my goal, you know. So that's a gist of the survey results we found out. Yeah. It's as good as a paid textbook.
And that is important to note. Yeah, I think research is showing over and over that students, they do as well. It's the same as a proprietary textbook. Their performance is, they don't go down because you've gone to OER basically. I would also add a little bit with any book, any course materials period, not just a book, any course materials, how much your students actually use them depend a lot on your pedagogy. If your pedagogy leads them to use that material, they will use it more readily than if they feel they get everything they need from your lecture and your PowerPoint notes. Why would they go to that text? Because I'm telling you right now, they are no longer trained like we were to use that as kind of supplemental knowledge. If they don't feel that material is necessary to do well in your class, if your pedagogy isn't leading them to it, they haven't been trained to use course materials that way, the way some of us were. My daughter went K through 12, and once she hit Georgia here, not a single textbook. They didn't use them in Effingham County. They didn't have them in the class. So the idea that a professor would expect her to read that on her own is entirely foreign to her. She's like, what is this thing? What do they expect me to do with this thing that I just paid $200 for?
Yeah, I would agree with that. And Beulah, when I was hearing you talk about the students going from the recorded lectures that you have and maybe choosing that over the textbook, what I do when I do my recorded lectures is I make direct reference. So I say, okay, before we start, please take out your textbook. And then, or like, please open up your textbook. Because I also assume that they can at least do a split screen. And so I'm actually constantly referencing what's happening in the textbook without screen sharing what's happening in the textbook so that they have no choice. Like, and then hopefully the hope is that they get lost in the textbook and they start looking at other things and, you know, they get excited about it. But I find that my students are often autodidactic. So they're really looking for me to spoon feed information to them. But I'm training practitioners, so I need you to know how to find this on your own, as opposed to depending on this outside person to do the work for you. So this is a skill that we're training in. Tanisha, I love your question about how does this change in terms of student success or the impact of it in terms of grades? Personally here, our students are way more engaged. And so I would say in terms of meeting the learning objective, having the open access resources, having the resources that are reflecting their interest, that are reflect, like what we sometimes will do when we're teaching a concept is if we know our students like a particular TV show, we can teach the concept in real time to the TV show that they're like, that they're watching. So then they engage so much more, and now they're able to understand that concept and skill. And so our students perform way better. Like, honestly, I would say we're covering about 2 to 3 times more material than we used to when we just had a textbook. Eula, Priya?
I can attest to that too, because even though, you know, we technically got the grant, successful grant only last year, you know, we've been implementing parts of it. And last fall, I did pilot the, you know, OER resource in just my section of the class. I had a small group, but I piloted only one section just to see how it would go. You know, I mean, it went very well, but I do kind of the same thing as you do. You know, I don't really lecture anymore. So I almost give like a 5-minute, 10-minute overview. And then in class, I mean, I will point to, you know, hey, this is the link. Okay. You're welcome to put your headphones on and watch this tutorial. I mean, I have converted a lot of the static text into multimedia tutorials just because, yes, students don't read anymore. They prefer to watch and learn. But I force them to do that in class. And it takes, I mean, 5 minutes per tutorial. So if we do 3, that's 15 minutes. We still have, we have a 2.5-hour class. So it's more like a lab session, right? So we have the time to do that. So which, you know, helps them to, when they're learning, to immediately go to that resource because they kind of almost trained to do that. In my section, I found that you know, the C grade students, those borderline, it bumped them up a little bit. The A students are A students. You know, whatever we do, it doesn't matter. They will do well. But then it's those borderline students. I really strongly feel like it helped those at-risk students to just at least, you know, boost up to a C or a low B grade.
In my class, unfortunately, I mean, I didn't see much. I'm saying it is after COVID hit, so I don't have data about the DWF. But one thing is definitely, you know, as Priya and Chelda said, it depends on how you use them. So that's what I want to work on in the future. It's not just creating a resource, but how you use the resource and how you encourage all those at-risk students to refer to this and make use of it is, I think, what matters more when if you want to pull the at-risk groups up. And I do want to go in that direction and change the way I use the textbook. And that's something I want to do coming up, yeah.
Thank you, Beulah. And I think you might agree with me that when you create your own resource, you become an expert of that resource. I get textbooks all the time that I never get to read from cover to cover. So because I have not mastered that textbook, it's going to limit how much I can endorse, engage, be enthusiastic about that particular static resource to my students. And so you've done all this work, Beulah, in creating this text. I think it's going to be a lot easier for you to say, go here, and that'll complement that way more than you might be able to do with a textbook that perhaps you haven't read. Because remember, by creating an OER resource, you're actually creating an amalgamation of all these other good resources. So it ends up being the best at the time for you.
Yeah.
Any questions from the folks in the audience? Here's one question that I might have right now if I'd never done this before. Where do I begin? It just feels overwhelming. Like, okay, yeah, we all told you that we failed the first time. It's not fun to think about you failing the first time. So you might think like, is that a rite of passage that you write this proposal, you put this working, and then it gets denied? It doesn't have to be. Where you begin is you might reach out to Nikki, or someone else in the library, but because you now know Nikki is right here, I would recommend start with her. But you reach out to Nikki and say, I'm interested in putting together a proposal. Nikki put for us in the chat the link for the ALG grant. If you want to go the route of being funded to do this work, I'm going to repost it. I just did in our chat. So you might click on that and just look at it a bit. I think myself and Beulah have already said we're willing to share the proposal that we wrote so that you can see it, and that could demystify it a bit. And then once you have your idea, maybe one other colleague who's teaching a similar course that you want to work on, and once you would probably see an example or you see what how much money you get, or, you know, is it worth it, then know this. Nikki will hold your hand through the process. Like, we just got a grant funded in October, to be honest with you. Once you figure it out one time, it's very easy to do it in the future. So when we wrote our second grant proposal, Nikki, was it like 1 week that it took us?
It was an incredible fast turnaround. I know that, incredibly fast.
Yeah. Like, I found out about the next round and I was like, hey guys, we're gonna do this. And they were like, okay. And then Nikki came to all of our meetings and she talked to us about how to tweak it, how to address this part, because they do have a simpler, clearer application process right now. So she was actually in our sessions while we're talking and figuring out how to put together a successful proposal. And we were able to add her name to the proposal, even though she's not receiving direct funding, we were able to add her name to it, which makes it a more successful proposal because they have like a point system. And so if you do have library associates supporting you in putting this together and committing to support you to do that, that shows to them that you have a greater commitment to doing a successful OER. So we're happy to hold your hand.
And do remember that ALG especially, ALG's main goal when it originated, and it's still one of their main goals, is simply affordability. You can completely adopt, y'all. And depending on your field, there is so much stuff already out there. We have had faculty groups just completely use a resource as is. No tweaking at all, like Beulah and her group did, and they've still been funded. We also have groups who are combining library resources in that. They're not open per se, but they're free to your students because we are paying for them. ALG doesn't make any distinction on that if you're looking for the funding from that group. They just want to see the cost that students are bearing for textbooks come down.
I see a question in the chat about in lots of cases, it's multiple sections, but ALG does have what is called a mini grant, which are smaller. So you don't have to partner with another faculty who teaches the same course. For example, my two team members don't teach the course. Okay? They have taught some form of programming in the past, but one team member is specifically, computer science faculty, and that's what his contribution has been to set up the website and to set up the analytics on that website. So you can form a team with you being the instructor and other resources like Nikki being the library guide support, and our other faculty and staff, and they can be paid through the grant for their support, depending on the level of support.
I think even if you have a small section, and I'm again going along with pre-acid, even if you're the only faculty teaching a small section, still, if you have already been gathering resources that students can refer to, if you have a bunch of references, you can put them together. And if you can cut down on some of the course costs because of the resources that you have been gathering, I think you can write a mini proposal and get that funded.
And there are also other options, as Chelda brought up in our last session. Y'all, we've also worked OER, I should say, Open Educational Resources, into the new campus-wide inclusive excellence plan. Dr. Tawan Wilson is offering some internal seed grants of around up to $700 per person for this work. So even with a very small course, with very small student outreach, you know, you could apply for one of those internal grants from that area to support that work, because you will be helping to support the work for inclusive excellence and diversity and inclusion on this campus.
I have a question again for Unity. So does applying for OER grants always have to be associated with bringing the costs down? Suppose you kept the cost same, but you created resources with inclusive excellence, which support inclusive excellence. Can that be?
Yeah, for the internal, I can't speak to that. I don't know what the criteria would be. We're still working on that for like the ones from Tawan Wilson. For ALG, I think they're gonna want to see some sort of decrease. And I remember they're also supporting that low cost, no cost initiative. Their cutoff is $40. So $40 is their cutoff to be able to count course materials as low cost within the system. So even if you create everything yourself, if you're still gonna be charging students $120, they're probably gonna be like, not sure we can fund this for you, okay? Now, some external grants, I'm not really sure. They may not have that criteria for the price to come down. You know, something from NSF or the federal government does OER grants, some of that nature. But OER traditionally, part of that open definition has been freely available.
What I want to add to that, and Beulah, what I thought I was hearing in your question was, could just finding really good resources be funded as opposed to just always replacing a textbook? And so ALG does have a supplemental materials or supplemental resources grant. So after you've already replaced your textbook, if you're like, okay, I wanna make that even better, I wanna revise and enhance with more diverse perspectives and things of that nature, there's a grant for that. And then what we learned in our last session was that there's even a way for you to negotiate something that's more creative and responsive to what students need. And I think at the end of the day, as long as whatever you're doing is gonna be below $40 and closer to being free, ALG could work with you to have that happen. And what I shared in the last session was there's a world where you could get a supplemental resources grant from ALG to revise your materials, but also couple that with the seed grant from the Office of Inclusive Excellence to make it culturally responsive and reflective of diverse perspectives.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
I have a question. This is Mahmoud. Sorry, I joined a little bit late to this webinar, but my question is about the software. So I have in one of my courses, we have hands-on activity in the lab, which basically doesn't cost anything for students, but we have a web-based portal that student needs to use in order to get the instruction for those activities and to perform some simulation. But for the simulation, I have purchased another software that we pay just one time fee for the license, and we have the software for our students. But still, we need our students to have access to the portal. And the only limitation that we have for that is that while we have the copy of those manual, we are not allowed to use those ones to make a copy and give it to students. And this cost our student like 140, 150 bucks for that course. And I hate that we have most of the material we already have. I was wondering if there's any way that we can just avoid using that web-based portal and just having a copy of the notes to them. But that, since it's a company property, I guess, I don't know how should I deal with that. Is there any way that we can get rid of this cost for our students?
The simulation that you have been using, so it's not really free then, right?
As I said, for that simulation that is web-based, mm-hmm. I got another software that software was only one-time expenses for our department, and we already had that one like two years ago. And so we don't need to pay for that software anymore, for the software. But for the web-based portal, every single user has to get that one. While we have all the materials from that portal, but my understanding is that I'm not allowed to create my own, let's say, portal and answering those questions and those content, let's say, in our folio. To not using that portal, and that's basically creating a lot of cost for our students.
Off my head, again, I'm not experienced with the engineering simulations part, but if it was something related to chemistry, for example, in chemistry, we have websites and publishers that offer simulations which are paid. And there are also chem collective resources which are free. So I would try to write my lab so that whatever is available for free can be used. So it seems like you may, I don't know if it is possible, but is it possible to change the kind of simulation you have been using and replace it with other options at all? Or?
Yes, it is possible to switch, but now the question is this, can we create a similar content of the other web base? Because, I don't know, it's kind of, probably it's mostly, I am not sure if I will be in a violation of the copyright, while I'm not going to necessarily copy and paste the content that they have. I can create my own content, but it will be, anyway, it will be similar because that's the principle of that course. I won't be able to change the whole thing. Even if I write it from the scratch, it will be very similar to what they wrote. So I don't know, maybe I should maybe have a meeting with you and maybe share the software environment and the web portal with you, and then you get familiar more. It would be maybe more clear to understand what I'm trying to explain.
Yeah, Mahmoud, I'm happy to take a look at what you're talking about too, because you know, you could start with just contacting the company and asking that, you know, this is what we're doing. Because, you know, the software that I use is MATLAB, and it's owned by MathWorks, a commercial company making lots of money. And they have their own tutorials, that, you know, my students do use, which are pretty good. But, you know, what I look at what we're doing is what any textbook would do, would use that software as a tool, but teach the concepts, the programming for engineers, okay, concepts, behind that. So in that sense, I'm not, you know, violating any tool. Students still have to download the software, but fortunately, ITS pays for that. So, or the university through ITS pays for it, and students get to install that software on their personal computers as well. And I'm happy to chat one-on-one with you at some point too.
Okay, yeah, that would be great if we can have that one. I mean, have a one-on-one chat to go over, because it's a slightly different from MATLAB. So I guess it would be better to take a look on the web portal that they have and the document that they. So I'll contact you later.
Okay,
thank you so much. Thank you, Mahmood. And thank you, Priya, for agreeing to follow up. I feel like this is so in the spirit of open ed resources, where people are just so interested in partnering, supporting each other, and collaborating. I hope if you've gotten nothing else from this session today, is that you have a team of folks who are already on your campus who are saying, I'll help you figure this out and navigate it. Okay, I think if there are no more questions, we only have a minute or two, then we could wrap up our session today, Nikki.
Absolutely. If everyone's okay with it, I am going to stop recording.